On today's episode of Star Wars Factions Compared, we're taking a closer look at generals. These are the guys responsible for getting boots on the ground, defending key planets, managing spec op groups, and often helping to plan the overall course of a war. Specifically today, we're looking at generals who led armies. That seems obvious, as general is often used as the army's counterpart to the naval admiral, but many Star Wars generals, like Yondo Donna, were primarily known for their prowess in space combat, so we'll be focusing on those who actually led forces on the ground, or at least will try to. That means as much as I'd love to wax poetic about Garmbel Iblis for 10 plus minutes, I'll have to save that for another time. Let's start with the Empire and General Maximilian Veers. Veers has not only one of the best names in Star Wars, but also one of the best resumes of any officer in the Imperial military. Unlike most in the Empire, Veers did not achieve his status through nepotism or personal connections, but rather through ability. Despite continually being sent on unwinnable or even suicidal missions, Veers not only survived, but thrived, and he could only be overlooked for promotions so many times. As he rose through the Imperial hierarchy, Veers would become a leading authority on AT-AT and General Imperial Heavy Walker designs and strategy. Eventually, Veers' tactics would be taught across the entire Empire. The general's greatness and pure competency was recognized by both Vader and Thrawn, and we get the following quote in the Galaxy Guide for The Empire Strikes Back. Veers is the most effective combination of cunning, ruthless efficiency, and loyalty to the Empire that the Imperial Army has ever produced. His career is noteworthy for the large number of former superiors who have placed themselves on record as being in support for him. He is one of the only living Imperial officers who doesn't have an all-encompassing fear of Vader, as the Sith Lord appreciates the general's ruthless and cunning nature. Unsurprisingly, by the time of The Empire Strikes Back, Veers was given full control of Vader's personal army within his Death Squadron, and was able to successfully assault the Rebel base during the Battle of Hoth, despite serious mistakes by other Imperial commanders. Maximilian Veers was easily on track to leading the entirety of the Imperial Army. His fate in canon is uncertain, though in Legends he survived until Operation Shadow Hand. Next up, we have the Rebel Alliance and General Crix Maedin. Like much of Rebel High Command, General Maedin was a former Imperial who defected to the Alliance, and soon became a crucial part of their war effort, using not only his inherent abilities and intelligence, but the top-of-the-line training he received at the Imperial Military School of Rhythal, one of the Empire's greatest academies. Crix was immediately identified as a rising star in the Empire, and was chosen to lead a Storm Commandos unit, an elite Spec Ops force. And he not only led the commando group, but picked and personally trained its members. Storm Commandos relied heavily on Alliance-style guerrilla warfare tactics, and were incredibly effective. However, after a series of ethically dubious orders, Maedin defected to the Rebel Alliance. Once there, he oversaw the development of the faction's ground forces, creating faction-wide tactics meant to make up for the Rebel Alliance's lesser numbers, taking advantage of his Storm Commando experience and, of course, his inside knowledge of the Imperial military. Maedin became one of the top two or three leaders within the Alliance, and directly guided the Rebels not only tactically, but on a macro level. The General's greatest success was the planning and execution of the raid on the Endor shield generator. He not only organized the stealing of the Imperial shuttle, and of course the shield code, but hand-picked the Alliance strike force which assaulted the shield generator. After Endor, he stepped back from general military planning and chose instead to lead the New Republic Special Operations and Intelligence Divisions, though he still at times saw wider action, including at the Battle of Mon Cala. Until his death, Maedin was considered the best in the galaxy at what he did, primarily leading lethal, advanced forces in unconventional warfare. He was known for employing fierce and unexpected tactics, using psychological warfare, and effectively managing resources. Next up, we have a Star Wars canon-only character, General Armitage Hux. And I know I'm somewhat going against my principle of ground tacticians here, but I did want to include a sequel trilogy character. Armitage was the son of Brendel Hux, who himself was an instructor at the Imperial Academy and a member of Gallius Rax's post-Endor Imperial Shadow Council. After Jakku, the two Huxes fled the known galaxy to help form the First Order, though, at this point, Armitage was still a child. Brendol had a vision for the new post-Imperial military. He wanted a Republic-style army of brainwashed, hyper-efficient soldiers. However, instead of clones, Brendol advocated for the use of kidnapped children. As his health began to fail, control of the growing army was given to Armitage, a cruel leader who forced the children to fight and harm each other even at a young age. Working with Ray Sloan, the younger Hux was taught his father's skills, while also being indoctrinated to the greatness of the former Empire. Hux oversaw the continued stormtrooper training, and presumably continued to rise in ranks until achieving the position of general. By the time of The Force Awakens, Hux was partially in control of Starkiller Base, and answered directly to Snoke. He's forced into the role of a secondary character in the movie itself, as the ship he commands, the Finalizer, is mostly being controlled by his rival, Kylo Ren. However, Armitage would have been largely responsible for the failure of the Starkiller base defense. He was not only incapable of stopping a small infiltration team, but failed to defend against a rather paltry starfighter attack. I'd also be remiss not to mention Hux's terrible defense of the Fulminatrix in The Last Jedi, and his ability to employ anything more than the most basic tactics when chasing down the Raddus. So, although we don't know a lot about the mind of Hux, much of the failures of the First Order can be directly tied to his personal responsibilities. On a completely separate note, we now have General Grievous, who is an interesting one, and is somewhat hard to rate, as his actions were almost totally controlled by Sidious. He also saw a wide degree of success and failure throughout the Clone Wars, depending, of course, on the specific battle. Obviously, Grievous is best known for his physical attributes. While those specifically aren't being ranked, the fact that he was able to lead his troops personally in battle and acted as a sort of mobile asset in and of himself is a huge benefit. He alone inspired dread in his enemies, though I guess the same can often be said of his own soldiers. Despite his brutish nature, Grievous was at the very least a competent military strategist, and he independently managed several fronts during the Clone Wars. Some believe that he was actually a tactical genius, and this is what the Star Wars Encyclopedia says. While Dooku managed the political side of the Confederacy, Grievous was the military leader of the Separatist armies. A brilliant strategist, he was unhindered by compassion or scruples. His lightning strikes and effective campaigns caused his reputation to grow in the eyes of a frightened Republic. Grievous first appeared in command of the Separatist forces during the Battle of Hypori, then began a march coreworld along the Corellian trade spine. He was considered by many military experts to have been a tactical genius, but others argued that, because he had limitless droids at his disposal, he lacked subtlety in his methods. The cyborg's natural abilities and intelligence was augmented by advanced computer systems within his brain, which not only helped him when developing deadly strategies, but when leading his troops in direct combat. Grievous was known during battles to completely lack compassion, and when available, would use hostages or take civilian populations under his control. I think it's notable that the general managed to wrangle different corporations and marshal the forces of several thousand systems in full-scale war against a galaxy of millions of systems. Operation Dirge's Lance, which saw the general pierce the Republic's core, was an example of a major victory. Grievous also pushed heavily for the use of advanced droid or superweapon models, but failed to fully integrate droid advancements into his larger overall army. The problem again is that it's hard to separate the successes of Grievous from the influence and manipulation of Palpatine. The kidnapping of the Chancellor, the attack of Coruscant, the loss at Utapau, and even Dirge's lances were only possible because of inside information from Palpatine. Still, there's no questioning the ferocity of General Grievous. So with our descriptions out of the way, let's take a second to rank these generals from worst to best. Coming in at number 4 pretty clearly is Armitage Hux. Hux just does not have the same sort of achievements, or really the same things said about him as the other members of these lists. He's definitely cruel, and he desires power, but I don't think we've seen anything really talk to his tactical abilities. Moving on from there is a little bit harder, but I think at number 3, I have to use General Grievous. I think the greatness of a general can be expressed by either the way they manage a war, or the way they handle individual battles. Grievous's best aspect, his ability to manage a galaxy-spanning war, was likely helped significantly by Dooku and Palpatine. However, his tactics during individual battles mostly seemed to rely on the sheer number of battle droids at his disposal. Still, he was definitely an incredible military leader, and I think the space between 3 and 2 is pretty small. Speaking of, both Mae Dean and General Veers are like the perfect representatives and the perfect generals for their factions. Mae Dean is great at using a few assets and waging guerrilla wars against a much larger enemy. He's good at using special forces and gathering intelligence. Veers, on the other hand, is incredible in a straight-up battle, perhaps one of the best pure ground tacticians the Empire had ever seen. I think it's pretty difficult to talk about the feats of these two men, so I just have to look at how they're described. And Veers has been said a few times to be the best officer within the Empire, and of course, for a while, that included Mae Dean. For that reason, Veers gets the number one spot and Mae Dean the number two. However, that's just my opinion. I would love to hear, what do you guys think? Also, how do you think a CIS super tactical droid would fit onto this list against these organic or semi-organic entries? All of that and more down in the comments. I'm gonna have to skip the question of the day today because, to be honest, I'm running late with some things, but I will continue to put two in subsequent videos. If you do have a question though, make sure to leave it down below with the hashtag AskEck. Until next time guys, this has been Eckhart's Ladder. May the Force be with you.